Hey, everybody, welcome to Voicebox! I'm Kathy Richardson, and today we are joined with a very special musical guest, the incredible Ann Harris.
Hey, everybody, Happy New Year.
All right, so anybody tuning in for the first time? Not in this room. If anyone is tuning in for the first time, Voicebox is a storytelling night with a musical twist provided by myself, and tonight also Ann Harris. We are going to listen to the storytellers one at a time come up, tell their personal true story in the theme, which is a song called New Beginning by Tracy Chapman. So they're going to tell their New Beginning song, and then I will sit in the listening audience with you, listening to the stories for the first time, and become spontaneously inspired to sing a song based on their story. Mayhem will ensue. The night will be woven before your eyes, never to be repeated again, unless you watch it again on Facebook, because we're going to just leave it there forever. All right. So I'm going to start. Ann and I are going to start with this Tracy Chapman song, New Beginning. The whole world's broke, ain't worth fixing. It's time to start all over, make a new beginning. There's too much pain, too much suffering. Let's resolve to start all over, make a new beginning. Now don't get me wrong, I love life and living. When you wake up and look around at everything that's going down all around, so you need to change it now. World with too few happy endings. You can resolve to start all over, make a new beginning. Start all over, start all over, start all over, start all over. Now the world is broken in fragments and pieces that were once joined together in a unified whole. But now too many stand alone. There's too much separation. We can resolve to come together in the new beginning. Yeah, we gotta start all over. Start all over. Start all over. Start all over. Break the cycle, we can break the chain, we can start all over in a new beginning. We can learn, we can teach, we can share the myths, the dreams, the prayer, the no ocean and we can do better. Change our lives and paths. Create a new world. And start all over. Start all over. Too much fighting, too little understanding. Yes, I'm starting over, make a new beginning. Yeah, we gotta start all over. Start all over. Start all over. Yeah, start all over. Start all over. Start all over. Start all over. Yeah. Thanks, everybody. All right. We are Voicebox live from the Jam Lab in Brookfield, Illinois. What? And we're going to bring up to the stage right now the hostess with the mostest, the creatrix of Voicebox, the redheaded, irreverent Reverend Maureen Muldoon.
Oh my God, you guys, this is history. Annie Harris and Kathy Richardson on stage singing Tracy Chapman at the Jam Lab. Does it get any hotter than this?
No, it does not.
Man, we needed this, didn't we? We were like, sayonara 2020, like, fuck you, we're out of here, you know, adios, you know, we're done. Like, we've lived it, we paid our dues, and then fucking 2021 came in and kicked
and it said, hold my beer. Yeah, what a week. What a week we've had.
Yeah.
And how timely, always. We didn't plan that there would be an insurrection this week when we picked this song, but...
No.
I mean, who could know? Except for the FBI and everyone.
Yes. Anyway. Yeah, well, you know what? We are going to start over. We're going to try something different. We're going to try and figure out with stories and songs if we might find that ever-eroding territory called common ground. You know, because that's what we really need right now is common ground. And we all have kids. We all have parents. We all have mothers. We all have fucking grandmothers who are muted on our Zooms. Grandma, you're muted. Grandma, you're muted. Grandma, fuck it. I mean, we all have those. We're all a part of the human family. So... this is the one place where stories and songs bring us back to the roots of our being. And these stories and songs, sometimes they're the only medicine left in the medicine cabinet. But we do have nurses here tonight, so God bless you. Thank you for doing the good work. Yeah, this thing called story and song is sometimes the flashlight in the darkness, and sometimes it's the life jacket in the sea of death, and sometimes it feels like the Xanax in the midst of a depression. And sometimes it's the last straw, and sometimes it feels like it's all we have left, and sometimes it feels like it's all we ever needed. And so I have found myself walked out of hell by stories and songs for the last 9 years, thanks to you guys, thanks to all you guys watching. And so we're going to do it again tonight. I hope that these stories and these songs help you to find a little solace in the midst of the storm. We have a great lineup. First of all, again, give it up for Kathy Richardson and Annie Harris, because they're going to take the helm tonight and ride us through this evening, and you'll get to see how story answers song and song answers story, and I'm looking forward to this in a big way. But we also have amazing storytellers. The top notch from Chicago, I got to say. We got some really great ones. We have Louise Anna, who's coming back. We haven't seen her in a while. We have Lisa Colleen, who's here. We have Mary Lou Edwards. We have Terry Falloon. Mary Lou and Terry Falloon are going to bring back our two-minute stories. So you'll get to see what a two-minute story looks like. And this is how we cultivated storytelling out here in the burbs. It was by helping people to just get on stage and tell a two-minute story, and you'll be surprised at how much information and inspiration and interest you can get from just 2 minutes. And then we're going to go back to the long form with Marie Costa, and Archie Archjay is closing the night. So you guys have a great, great lineup, and I want to welcome up our first storyteller, Louise Anna.
Hello. Fitzgerald's looks really different. Thank you, Miss Muldoon, for giving me something to take a shower for and get changed. So I'm Louise. My middle name is Anna, so technically my name is Louisiana. So new beginnings. I don't have much to say about new beginnings because I'm 15, and that's a really short amount of time to be alive. So I've been in the same class with the same people that I really don't like since fifth grade. But hearing the song and the performance, I watched the live version of Miss Chapman, and it was really, really special. I really liked this song. And hearing your performance was really beautiful. I really liked it. So I don't know about you guys, but I've been trying to watch more like classic movies that we've all forgotten about with all the open time. I just watched the movie The Big Lebowski for the first time. And I just want to say this dude abides. That was a really good movie. I think that with pandemic life, we've all had too much time on our hands. Some of us rearranged the furniture in our houses. Some of us got divorced. Divorce rates have been up, and those two go hand in hand. And some of us on walks, the sacred going outside, which we don't get to do much of, and then getting that feeling of relief when the really, really annoying friend that you run into doesn't recognize you because you have your mask on and you don't have to talk to them. Thank you for the two laughs that I got. Woo! Sorry, I lost my place. But I think we can all agree that we huddled around the TV in November for the big thing that happened. I think everybody knows what I'm talking about, right? Does everybody know what I'm talking about? Queen Elizabeth announced that she would no longer be buying real fur, and she would switch to fake fur. So give it up for Queen Elizabeth II. Yes. I'm just kidding. That's not the thing that happened in November. You guys know the thing that happened in November. You guys know what I'm talking about. It was something really big. It happened on national television. I think a lot of people were watching all over the world. Elon Musk's new car with shatterproof windows shattered live on stage when tested. Yeah, give it up for Elon Musk. I'm just kidding. There was a thing that happened in November that happened on TV. I'll say it. The National Dog Show welcomed its first Belgian Lachinois dog to the breeding category. And those are the only things I'm going to talk about that happened in November. Give it up for the National Dog Show. So when thinking about new beginnings and the long life that I've lived, I think about the biggest thing I've had to do and the biggest change that I've made for myself, which was, drum roll please, the day that I deleted my Instagram. No! Dun, dun, dun. Yeah, so that was probably the only hard thing that I've ever been through. I don't know. Raise your hand if you have Facebook or Instagram. I didn't delete my account, just the app. they're basically the same thing, except one is for old people, and the other one is for booty pics and how cute you think your dog is. Now raise your hand if you take frequent breaks from your social media, which is healthy to do. No one's raising their hand. Yeah, so I decided I'm going to strap on my bravery seatbelt during the pandemic time, which is a weird time to take away something that brings so much joy in your life. But I did it. I deleted my account. And never tell 15-year-old girls that you deleted your Instagram account, because they're my friends' reactions, you would have thought that I told them I was cutting off my limb and donating it to someone. You can't live without it. You're gonna need it. You're gonna have FOMO. Now, I'm in a room full of really old people, so FOMO means fear of missing out. And I mean, I wasn't missing much. I mean, if you've been on any 15-year-old girl's Instagram, it's just, you know, selfies with the dog, selfies at grandma's house, bathroom selfies. Those are real. People go into the bathroom with their phone, which is kind of weird. Do you know how much bacteria is on your hands, let alone in the bathroom? And then they take a photo of themselves with their grandma's toilet in the background. I don't understand that. But, I mean, my Instagram account is pretty, I guess, abnormal to the selfies. I have photos of my really cute dog, silly comedy videos that I make, which, by your guys' reaction, I guess I'm not that funny. Oh, I'm just kidding. Thank you. I'm just kidding. Yeah, so I wasn't really missing out on much, but I really want to know how you guys, lived your life without telling the 27 people that follow you what you had for breakfast. I it sucks. I hate not having Instagram. I've done it for 6 months. I don't know how I've done it. And what's the point of life without sharing it with your grandma and your aunt who lives in Louisiana, who you'd never get to see, who drinks a lot? What's the point of not sharing that with those people and then the random people that follow you? I'm just kidding. My account is private, so I don't have any creeps in my Instagram. But seriously, imagine if you guys at my age had every impulse selfie you posted on the internet forever, and then you can look back on it when you're your age. That doesn't actually sound that good. Imagine if Marilyn Monroe was today's Instagram hoe, and she was the one posting selfies. That would be fun to see what Marilyn Monroe would post on her Instagram. That's how old you guys are. or imagine if Farrah Fawcett was in your DMs. That would be pretty great. I'm just kidding. That sounds really bad. But with new beginnings, whether that be adding a new dog breed to the National Dog Show, give it up for the National Dog Show. Adding faux fur to your closet, new beginnings, or deleting your social media, which I recommend. New beginnings gives us a fresh washover that I think we've all needed, saying, as Miss Muldoon put it, fuck you to 2020. but I think instead of running away from the new, which sometimes people do, I think we should embrace it and welcome it into our homes. Not literally, we're not supposed to touch each other. But that's the lesson for today's story. Welcome the new, and say goodbye to 2020, and let's give it up for the great year that 2021 is going to be. Thank you.
Louisiana! All right. What in the world could a person play? That was... It was really good, but I felt bad for singing it to her story. Okay. This is a parody of a real song that I don't really know very well, so let's see if we can do this. Look at this Instagram, Eggs Benedict side of ham. Started out as a lemon tart, then my phone went and made it hard. These are my fingernails, the beauty is in the details. Drinking my ties on a cruise, just a coincidence, it's also boobs. Everyone look at my feet, so jealous that I'm on the beach. You probably knew I was going there. You saw my plane swing in the air. Are you bored of the city lights? Try to see them in black and white. Putting glasses on the cat. I'm the first one to think about. He thinks his people. Every time I take a photo of an old door, signing out in front of an abandoned store. Such a thrill to add a filter. Lo-fi, lo-fi. Okay, I don't know. This is a part I don't know. I'm really sorry. Every time a thing reminds me of a penis, every fortune cookie that I've ever seen is on my. Get 5 likes, 5 likes. I'm really sorry. Look at this coffee foam. Now look at this pretentious tome. Now look at this garden gnome. I'm a freaking Michelangelo. Fireworks in the sky, super close up of my eye. Now a selfie looking cute in the same room where I poop. Sometimes I just want to browse 100,000 pics of clouds. Hang on, I need to get this duck. Hold still, goddamn it, fuck. Oh no, oh no, it's all blurry. No, you haven't really ever seen a setting sun till you've seen it in the tempera. So help on a documenting. Peach pie, peach pie. Think it's bad now, wait till I'm 33. So many pictures of my kids, you wanna murder me. Miss these first steps, cause I'm obsessed. Obsessed, obsessed with red eye, red eye, red eye. We'll be right back. Yes. Oh, ladies, I had to zoom in on my screen.
Perfect song for that story. Where did you come up with that one?
That was a viral video like 7 years ago. I don't know. Look at this Instagram to the tune of Look at This Photograph by Nickelback. And then they recently spoofed it again, spoofing themselves in a commercial, which I thought was pretty funny. And it, they made a commercial for Google Photos or something.
That was awesome. I need a good laugh. In the same room that you poo. That's awesome. I love that. Our next storyteller has been here before. She always brings a great story for us. Really sweet storyteller, and this is a great one. Give it up for Lisa Colleen. Colleen Lisa. Lisa Colleen. I don't know why. I'm sorry about that. Let me clean off your mic.
That's good.
Yeah, she's changed her name. Go back to your maiden name. Go back to your
maiden name. Yeah, that's right. Here, wait. Let me get that for you. Lisa Colleen, like I said before.
And of course, my story is about being a grandma. Of course. So I'm in my favorite room of my house. It's my grandkids' room. And there are toys everywhere. There's books, there's blocks, there's dolls, and more. And I came in here to think, because I want to sell this house, but I'm really having a hard time letting it go. Like, once I move, my grandkids will no longer sleep over in this room that's theirs, where they each have their own bed. Like, my girls, Carmela and Val, who are 8 and 6, they sleep on beds that were mine and my sister's when we were kids, and comforters that I sewed for them. Now the third, Maximus Hawk, the third child just has a crib mattress in the corner, but he's made it his own. He has like a little puzzle case and he keeps all of his dogs stacked up on top of it. So I'm laying on Carmela's blue bed and I call my oldest, their dad, to tell him my news. And I'm a little bit nervous because I don't know if he's going to be upset. So I tell him, hey Ken, I'm going to sell the house and I'm going to move to the city. And without missing a beat, he says, Mom, I'm so happy for you. So I'm relieved, but I'm like, Ken, this is your childhood home. Are you sure? And he says, Mom, it was a great childhood home. Let it be someone else's childhood home now. And so I'm feeling a little bit better, like Ken's behind this. He's happy for me. He wants me to do this. So I call my realtor, Amy. She shows up at my house, my very colorful house. Now, Amy's my friend, so I know that she really likes me. No, I know, she really does. So I'm hardly offended when she just waves away anything that looks at all like me. In the living room, she says, manage your plants. Get rid of them. Take the few that you're going to take with you, and the rest need to go. In the hallway, she looks at the photographs and says, get rid of these. Now, these aren't pictures of my kids. These are pictures of my grandkids. And then we go into the grandkids' room, and she takes that realtor hand, and she waves it, and she says, declutter this. Now, she might see clutter, but I see these tangible ties to my children's childhood. So I close that door, and I let her just finish waving her little realtor hand. Amy's clearly ready for me to make this move, and she's very willing to help. So she leaves. I get myself to work. I load up my car again and again and again, and I take it to Savers, and I get rid of stuff, and I get rid of more stuff, and I get rid of more stuff. Now, at the time, I was working at a university, so I listened to Amy. I put 30 spider plants in the trunk of my car, and I drove them to work. I put them on a cart, and I wheeled them through the cafeteria like the, you know, crazy plant lady. And the college kids swarmed me, and each grabbed a plant, and they all walked away with a plant in their hand, a smile on their face. My house was less cluttered, and the dorm rooms had a little bit more life in them. And then I take down the pictures in the hallway. I decide, you know what? I don't have to have those displayed to stay close to the loves of my life. And every time that I walk back into my house and it's less cluttered, I realize, you know, the stuff that I have left, the stuff that I'm keeping, I appreciate even more than I did when there was so much other stuff there. And I call my friend Brian. Hey, do you have time to paint my house? And he slots me in between jobs. It seems like he's ready to help me make my new beginning. So, according to Brian, gray is the in color. Boring, blah, gray. So I buy myself a shit ton of gray. He comes over and he paints over the 5 shades of green, the 3 shades of blue, the 2 shades of pink, the pale yellow, and the bright orange. And I'm at work when he does this. So I plan to be sad when I walk home, walk in the door, and realize that this house no longer looks like mine. And I walk in, and you know, I don't hate the gray. It actually looks kind of clean, fresh. I'm starting to feel like I'm ready to do this. But that one room, I have a really hard time letting go of that one room. Like decades ago, this was my son's room. They had one of those bunk beds where there was a twin on top and a full on bottom, and Ken slept on top, Nick slept on the bottom, and their sister Teresa every night came in and crawled in with Nick so that they all three could be together. And then on Christmas Eve, they came up with this ritual. They called it junking it up. And what they did was they grabbed every pillow and every blanket in the entire house and threw it into this tiny 10 by 10 room, and they all junked it up all night waiting for Santa. So I'm in this room. It's now Ken's kids' room. So even though Amy waved her little hand and said, get rid of everything, I just can't bring myself to do it. And then the grandkids come over for a sleepover. And Carmela, the oldest, says, Grandma Silly, can we play camping and have a sleepover in your bedroom? And of course I say yes, because I say yes to anything that they want. So the girls, they grab cushions from the sunroom and they make beds on the floor. And Maximus Hawk, he drags his crib mattress across the hallway and makes his bed. And we have a lovely camping adventure. And then as I'm driving them home, Carmela tells me, Grandma, that was so much fun. And I think, you know, they might not actually need to have a room in my home. They might not need their very own room. So after they leave, I listen to Amy, and I donate stuffed animals. I donate puzzles, I donate building blocks, and more. And I can almost hear my son say, Mom, let those be other people's toys now. And that in our next sleepover, Carmela and Maximus, they decide to climb in bed with me. And Valerie, she goes and gets the cushions from the couch, which is one of the very few pieces of furniture I'm bringing with me. And I realize, you know what? I think they're ready. We all climb into this chair, and I start scrolling through my phone, looking at cool apartments, and they're getting on board. Grandma, they say, we have never slept in an apartment before. It's going to be so much fun. So it seems like everybody's really behind this. They're ready. And I realize I'm ready too. I am ready to kiss this house, my home of 30 years, goodbye. And Amy calls. Lisa, we have an offer on the house. It's a family with 3 kids. They're renting a teeny tiny home, and they're so excited to have all that space. And the parents come over to show the kids the house, and I get to give them a tour. And of course, I tell them a story or two in every single room. They loved them all. And then their oldest looks at me, and he says, it is such a beautiful house. And I know, and I can see, like, they're going to be happy there. This is going to be their house. This gray house is going to be theirs. So I move into my 17th floor apartment in the South Loop. It has 4 rooms. It's got a kitchen, a living room. Look at me thinking like there's 4 rooms, and I'm Let's see, there's the living room, there's the kitchen, there's the bedroom, and there's the bathroom. And you know what? It doesn't feel small. I think partly because the ceilings are so high, like when I burn dinner and the fire alarm goes off, I have to pull over like a really high chair and stand on it and get the broom to stop it from beeping. And then there's this one wall that's all windows. And the view, it's just expansive. And I stand there and I think to myself, what a perfect reminder that if I live open, my life can expand in ways that even I can't think of. Oh, thanks. So Ken brings the kids for a sleepover in the city. The tour doesn't take very long, poor rooms. And he says to me, Mom, all the walls are white, and yet you managed to make this entire apartment green. And I have. Like, green is my color. It's the color of luck. It's the color of life. And I'm so happy in my green place. And as he leaves, he hugs me and he says, Mom, I'm so proud of you for having this adventure. And I'm super excited about the adventure of the sleepover in the city. So we take a tour of the building, and as we're exploring, the two little ones take their jobs very seriously. Like in the elevator, Valerie swipes the fob. Maximus pushes the buttons. And we go down to the fourth floor. There's this really fancy lounge, and we decide to watch a little bit of TV. Well, the TV is in Spanish, and none of us can figure out how to change that, so let's see if I can do this. Los chicos Los chicos y yo vemos la televisión en español. Thank you. I know we got Ann Harris, we got Kathy, and I'm doing Spanish. So we leave the fancy lounge, and Valerie swipes that fob, and Maximus Hawk pushes the button. And we go home to my apartment in the 17th floor. And we're just in time to watch the sunset. And we look at that yellow sun, the blue sky, and then there's an orange, and there's a pink stripe going across it. And it's so vivid, really so much prettier than all those colors that used to be on the walls of my house. And our evening is filled with stories and laughter and games and a little bit more laughter. And then at bedtime, Carmela finds her favorite blue blanket, and she makes a bed for herself on the couch. Valerie pulls the old crib mattress out from underneath my bed, and she junks it up. And Maximus Hawk gets into bed with me. And as we fall asleep, I'm looking out the window at the lights of the city, and I'm surrounded by my loves. And I realize I am so ready for my new beginning.
Lisa Colleen. Grandma got run over by a reindeer. No, just kidding. Got a roof over your head and a warm bed and a solid built on stone. Got a key in your hand and your pocket, only you can lock it. But the tears will fall in the silence. You're alone without love. This ain't never gonna be no home. And you like day, got a job. Maybe get a raise one day, so you work hard, force a smile and do your best. Just a needle in a haystack, but you're making your paycheck. And you know you can't get those years back. It'll never be your own without love. This ain't never gonna be no home. You won't spend your whole life crying. Ain't gonna cash it in without even trying. For you know before love can ever even begin, it must start from your own heart and radiate out from within. So ain't you lucky you got a home? Mm-hmm. You got the sky over your head. Bed is your bones. You got a father and a mother. You've got billions of sisters and brothers. We must love ourselves and each other to be strong. Without love, this ain't never gonna be. You may want it to, but it just won't be. Without love, this ain't never gonna be. No
This will work better if I take my mask off. Terry Falloon is here, and we call him Mr. Voicebox. He's been around from the beginning. And he's got a short story. This is one of the two-minute stories. And then Mary Lou Edwards is coming up right after him. Following that, we are bringing up Maria Costa. So come on up, Terry.
Thank you. Hi, thanks to everybody. Really a pleasure to have you here tonight, Ann. Really special treat for all of us. So great story so far. On December 31st, 1979, New Year's Eve for 1980, I truly came the closest that I ever came to dying, and it was bad. I drove my nice Christmas, or my nice Plymouth Duster into this concrete bridge, down a 15-foot embankment, and landed in the middle of the Hocknum River in Connecticut. Fortunately, the Hocknum River is only about 4 feet tall, 4 feet high, so it wasn't that horrible. I went to, in an ambulance, I went to the emergency room, and they let me out 6 or 7 hours later, so it's like 9 o'clock in the morning on January 1st, 1980. And I realized I don't have a car, I don't live in Connecticut, I have to hitchhike to Massachusetts, which I did. And when you hitchhike, you have a lot of time to contemplate things and new beginnings, perhaps, on January 1st after you trash your car and almost kill yourself. So I eventually got to my apartment and said, I'm going to write me a poem after all this reflection that I did. I realized, and I'm going to read that poem to you, I realized today that it is one of the few poems that I have ever that it was called Untitled 1180. So 41 years ago, I wrote this poem, and I'm going to title it tonight, New Beginnings, so yay. So cut me some slack. I'm a 19-year-old kid. I'm really hungover still, and my body is aching, and I'm really depressed and humiliated and possibly a complete idiot. And so I wrote this that I now call New Beginnings. I became aware last night of what is wrong and what is right for me. I took the blinds that hid my eyes, exposed myself to tragic lies, turned around, caught myself by surprise. And now I'm free from compromise. Winged as condors, blessed as saints, the time has come. It hurts to wait. Questions seal my waking thoughts. I seek answers, despite what I've been taught. I need to hold another's dream, find the ocean in a stream, improve upon what I've been given, take my blind eyes, make them keen. And if I fail, I fail myself. I ask the aid of no one else. I found that I must travel light. Yes, I became aware last night. So. Mary Lou Edwards.
I want to give a plug to Maureen. I don't know if this counts as part of my 2 minutes, but what I'm about to read, is the result of some prompts that come from a writing group. These prompts didn't come from Maureen's writing group, but that is Maureen's specialty. So for those of you who've not participated in Maureen's writing group, you're missing a whole lot, and you may write the story of a lifetime. So I'd suggest you get in touch. My daughters were adopted from Colombia. One was 4 years old, the other was 10 years old. They were not biologically related. The 4-year-old was abandoned at birth. The 10-year-old was a street child. There are lots of stories that emanate from this situation, but I decided to write a book of short events that would help my daughter, particularly Leah, who was always interested in our family history. And the book is entitled Letters to Leah, Hard Copy So You Never Forget. So here are a couple of the vignettes that come from this book that resulted from prompts that came from postcards. The one postcard is a woman, and she's standing next to a skeleton, and it says, "The old rules no longer apply." Leah, trust me, for a very long time I played by the rules. Don't waste your time. They get changed when you least expect. Heed the Ten Commandments, use your head, listen to your heart, and pick your battles. Follow your moral compass, the golden rule, and know that you never walk alone. The rest is bullshit. Namaste, mommy. My sweet Leah, you were always dreamy in every way. From the time you discovered my scarf drawer, you floated through the house draped in silk squares like a mini courtesan. Your first Halloween, you chose to be a bride with a long, white, flapping veil blowing in the breeze. Your world was always filled with creative imaginings, inspired paintings, lovely writing, and wondrous books of fantasy. You lived on the corner of pretend and make-believe in La La Leah Land. And then we were diagnosed together. The doctor found it interesting that we share no biological connection, but we do share attention deficit disorder. Did he not realize that God made a perfect match? Someday we will discover the land to which all of our keys, eyeglasses, books, and belongings magically disappeared. It is not easy, Leah, being a dreamer. And the last one that I will read is a postcard that has a picture of a little girl. Mommy, when I grow up, I want to help smash the white racist, homophobic, patriarchal bullshit paradigm, too. Leah, you grew up wanting to smash the racist, homophobic, patriarchal paradigm. I grew up living it. Girls in the old neighborhood weren't supposed to figure it all out, so I feel blessed that I kind of did. Don't ever be content with just sitting there. Do something. Mother Jones said it best. Pray for the dead and fight like hell for the living. Love, Mommy.
We love this storyteller. We got to see her when we were at Fitzgerald's, and she's back here, her first story at the Jam Lab. How awesome is the Jam Lab, everybody? Is this not like the coolest kid's basement that you somehow got invited to? Anyway, here's Maria Casa.
It's 5 o'clock in the afternoon. My roommate is gone for the night, and I'm alone in my house. I look at the plants, pillows on the couch. My jacket hangs from the chair. Soon, it's going to be dark. I'm not used to being alone on New Year's Eve. I have worked at least 30 New Year's Eve nights, smiling, pouring a little empathy with each drink that I make, bartending. I love bartending. I love it more than teaching. I love it more than training. I love bartending. And now, right now, tonight, I miss it. I'll see friends tomorrow. I mean, I'm going to be with good friends tomorrow and celebrate, but right now, I don't want to be alone. So I decide I'll go out and see what I'll attract. I get in the car and go down to the lake. There's a parking spot right there. Great, everything's working out for me. I walk to the park and I scan. There's a big fire to my left, 7 or 8 bodies. There's a smaller fire to my right with 2 other bodies. I take a breath. I feel good. I feel relaxed. I feel safe. So I walk down to the beach. I give the beach a scan. Not a soul around. I'm the only one on the beach in Chicago with Lake Michigan. But I asked for this path, this kind of mystic path, Sometimes it's a little lonely. I asked for it, even before high school. I mean, I was reading The Nature of Reality, The Lost Years of Jesus, Carlos Castaneda's. I was doing drugs, not to get high or have a good time with my friends. I was doing drugs for spiritual development. At 16, I walked down the beach, and I was always searching, searching, searching. There were gurus, there were retreats, there was meditations, there were teachers. I got lost in the dark, I got found in the light, searching, searching, and now, you know what, no more searching. Now I can have it. Now I can have it, I think. I asked for this. I listened to the waves, and the waves are loud, but my voice is louder, and I start to call out for guidance, and I say, help me. I need a sign. I need a physical sign in my face. Not the little voices I hear in my ears. That is not enough. No, not the messages and the dreams. Too much room for interpretation. I need a physical thing, something in my face. Because I have done the work. I've taken the steps, and now I'm out here. And then I do a walking meditation. And I take in the clouds, the city lights, and I say out loud, because I can, I love this city. I love it. And on the way out of the park, I lean against a tree. I feel my hands on the bark. And I appreciate being alive and being healthy right now. It's getting cold. I do love the city, even in the cold, but it's getting really cold, so I decide it's time to leave, and I start to walk out. And as I walk out, two people are walking by me just at this right moment, and they turn around and they say, Happy New Year. And I say, Happy New Year to you too, brave souls that we are out in the cold. And this man says, hey, go warm up at that fire over there. Go on, tell them Sam sent you, they're my friends. And I go, what? Yeah, go warm up at the fire. And he walks away. Is Sam my guidance? I mean, am I getting answers this fast? I start to think, should I intrude on these people on New Year's Eve? Should I break into someone's fire circle? And I'm starting to think and think, but my feet take me right to the fire. And I say, hey, are you friends of Sam's? And I wonder if it's a code. And they say, yeah, why, who are you? And I go, I just saw him down the road, and he told me to come up and have a beer. And this guy goes, here, you want a beer? And he opens a can of beer for me and hands it to me, and I take it. And at this moment, I am so happy that I drink. I look at the can, and I say, Three Floyds beer. And David Bowie music playing. This is a great way to go into the New Year's Eve. And he goes, nice notice. And then he goes back to his friends, and they all start talking amongst themselves. I look around. There's Lou Malnati's pizza boxes. There's backpacks on the ground. There's cigarettes, I'm surprised, and there's phones. I wonder what they're thinking. I see that they're about in their 30s, maybe, but what do they think I am? I mean, they can't see my neck because I've got a scarf on. They can't see my hands either because my gloves are on. My hair is in a hat, so they don't know what color my hair is. And as I'm going around, all of a sudden, this one comes up to me, and she interrupts my thoughts, and she says, hi, I'm Vicky. Hi. And Vicky and I start to talk, and she says, what are you doing out here by yourself? I say, you know, just a little prayer and a meditation. Hey, Jeremy, she's a meditator. And then Jeremy comes over and he goes, that's cool, you're a meditator? I've been meditating for 12 years, 15 hours, 15 minutes a day, he tells me. And my therapist and I are working on it. And Jeremy tells me that he's got OCDC or OCD. And that he told himself he was going to meditate for 15 minutes a day, and now he can't stop, and he's working on it with his therapist. And I suggest, well, maybe it's nothing that you really have to fix. And so we talk, and we're drinking beers, and we're laughing. And we're laughing, and the Beatles are playing. And the Beatles are playing, and I'm thinking, whose playlist is this? Like, I love this. I love this music. And Lou Reed comes on, and I go, I grew up with this music. And Vicky goes, how old are you anyway? I said, well, I'm 65, but right now I kind of feel like I'm 35. And they go, you are. You're with us tonight. You're 35. And we all start laughing again, and we have some more beers. Another friend joins. He joins the circle, and he tells everybody that he has a new girlfriend. And then he comes, and he stands right next to me. And he said, you know what? I think my girlfriend's like a witch. Do you think you can help me? I said, what? And he goes, well, you know, she's into astrology and spirituality and yoga and all that shit. I don't know anything about it. Can you help me? And then he says, listen. And he pulls out his phone, and he goes, I have to show you what she told me, and I'm going to read it. I'm going to read it so I don't get it wrong. And he said, the arrow doesn't seek the target. The target draws the arrow. I say, that's cool. That's cool. I have one for you, too. The lighthouse doesn't go out and save the boats. She just stands there and shines. I said, I bet your girlfriend will like that. And he likes it. He thinks it's really cool. The moon comes out, and it's orange, and it's got its light around the water, and we all look up, and the Beatles song comes on across the universe, and one woman says her brother's in the Air Force, and he sees UFOs all the time, but he can't tell anybody, and we are together, and they tell me how they know each other, and they've gone to college together, and two of them are teachers, and one's studying to be a doctor. They never ask me what I do, and I don't care. They are talking about Matthew McConaughey's new book, Green Lights. I've never read it, so I make a mental note to catch up. We feed the fire, and I ask, did you all just come out here to drink beers and just get high and have a good time, or are you doing some kind of a ritual? Ritual? We don't know any rituals. Jeremy says, can you lead us in a ritual? So we form a tighter circle. All right, first, let's feel our feet on the earth. Let's mentally thank our feet and our legs for getting us through the year of 2020. And here we are right now in December. I know I better go fast because they're really young and they probably don't have the attention span that I had when I learned rituals. Let's mentally call back all of our energy, any energy that you have left in the last year, January, February, March, call it back. And I start naming things that we had talked about. That girl that broke up with you, that job that you lost, call back your energy. Call back your energy until you're feeling really strong. And now, feeling really strong, bend down and pick up the first stick you find. And everybody bends down and picks up a stick. And I pick up a stick too. And I say, and now, feeling all of your strength, I want you to make a decision. What are you going to let go of in 2021 and make room for? I said, I'll start. And I throw my stick in the fire and I say, I'm letting go of doubt. And they all take part in it. Some of them out loud. Some of them are just doing it quietly. At the end, Jeremy offers me another beer and he goes, God, that was so cool. Here, you earned it. The fire starts to go out. We eat the pizza. We throw the Lou Malnati's boxes in. It's only 8:30, but there's not going to be any more fire. I thank them for letting me in their circle, and they say, we don't know any other way. And so I walk out of the park with the witch's boyfriend. He tells me he's driving to Indiana that night. And so I tell him where, if he hurries up, he can get a bottle of champagne within the next half hour before the store closes. I go home, I go to sleep before midnight, but I am feeling really, really good. No doubt about it. Thank you.
Maria Costa, that was amazing. Jeez. I took it up to E, could we do that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Words are flowing out like endless rain into a paper cup. They slither wildly as they slip away across the universe. Pools of sorrow, waves of joy are drifting through my open mind, possessing and caressing me. Guru Deva, home. Nothing's gonna change my world. Nothing's gonna change my world. Nothing's gonna change my world. Images of broken light which dance before me like a million eyes. They call me on and on across the universe. Thoughts meander like a restless wind inside a letterbox. They tumble blindly as they make their way across the universe. Nothing's gonna change my world. Shades of laughter, shades of life are ringing through my open ears, exciting and inviting me. Limitless, undying love which shines around me like a million suns and calls me on and on across the universe. Jaguar Deva, oh, nothing's gonna change my world. Nothing's gonna change my world. Nothing's gonna change my world. Jaguar Deva.
For all you guys watching on the live stream and sending in your tips and financial support, thank you so very, very much. You know, yeah, it's really you know, nothing's going to change my world except for, you know, Kathy Richardson still has to pay the rent. You know what I mean? So some things are going to change your world when the whole system goes down to sand and you're no longer doing the gigs that you're used to. Like you mentioned that you don't bartend anymore. So by the grace of God, we all have been able to get by. But, you know, supporting local businesses like Lab Jam and our artists and our musicians that we've been so grateful to have with us, gosh, that's priceless. So thank you for supporting Voicebox all of these years and specifically during this time. We have our last storyteller up, and Archie Archjay, great storyteller, always just completely delights me. And you can see him all over Chicago area. He tells stories, as do all of the storytellers, but he's a treat, and I'm really glad that he's with us tonight. Please give it up for Archie Archjay.
Oh my God, this has been fantastic. I am so ready for 2021. It's 8:45 on a Friday night in July. The Zoom fundraiser I was part of had been cut short, and I had a decision to make. Should I stay home or stop by our roommate's birthday party to have a quick drink on a patio and pick up my fiance, Jeremy? I have every reason to stay home. I'm a server working 12-hour pandemic days in the summer sun and on the concrete. So I'm not only a tired server, I am also the mask police. I can eagle eye 6 feet with the accuracy of a tape measure. I'm a daily statistics checker and a public reference to the safety guidelines that need to be implemented and followed. And thus, I'm aware my roommate's party at a shut down indoor bar is totally illegal. And I fucking hate it. When he first mentioned the ideas weeks ago, I didn't give it much thought because it was weeks off. And one week is ambitious long-term planning at this point. The Wednesday before, however, I'd asked Jeremy, my partner, through life's trials, if we could just skip the party and buy him dinner on a patio instead. So Charles's birthday, I don't think it's gonna be a small party. And it's inside? Can we just skip it? I have to go. I promised him. Jealousy is part of our love language. He is Puerto Rican. I am a Thai ladyboy. Maybe those aren't the reasons. But we both, at times, adore our jealous tendencies. And though we've done a lot of work to undo the bad parts, I was not raised to hear my fiancé make a promise to another man over me. And since Charles had moved in 2 months ago, I'd become increasingly jealous. Something I was aware of and humbly admitted to Jeremy. See, they just got along better. They had more boy things in common. Their casual friendship blossomed during quarantine, while Jeremy and I struggled to find things to do now that most of the outside world was closed. I hated waking up at 2 a.m. to an empty bed, only to find Jeremy in Charles's room playing video games. I felt like they sat strangely close on the couch. But Charles is a straight guy who likes musicals. And though he has really small hands, he is really attractive. And Jeremy is a top, so he's not a size queen. I mean, look, I'm not saying I'm right, and I'm not saying I'm uncrazy, but that's the point. Jeremy has always protected me from my insecurities. A month ago, I had asked Jeremy to talk to Charles about moving out. I knew we would fight over this party, he said. I rolled my eyes, because this was exactly the kind of reason I wanted Charles to move out. That Friday night, July 23rd, I decided I would trust them and go. I trusted that, as we agreed, Jeremy would stay on the patio during the party, and that, as Charles said, no more than 8 people were gonna show up. And if so, Jeremy would leave. Jeremy sent me a video at 6:30, and there were only 3 people there. At 9 p.m., I texted Jeremy that I was on my way. Meeting Jeremy was the right thing to do because it would help squash the jealousy I felt. I needed to become a better version of myself. And I really thought life was challenging me to do so. I needed to embrace Charles as a friend, as Jeremy's friend, and see my jealousy for what it was. Unnecessary emotion. Apparently not. When I arrived at the party, the patio was empty. I tightened my mask and opened the bar side door. I took a few steps in and peeked around a corner. Before my eyes could even comprehend the entirety of the 24 or so shadows, a 20-something without a mask barreled at me, about to puke. I launched my 40-year-old body out the door. I picked up the phone and dialed. Are you inside? Yeah, that's all I need to know. I quarantined my fiance and Charles in the basement together. For the next week, I stomped the floors above, relived Beyonce's Lemonade, and thought about that promise while fiddling with the ring on my finger. My blood ran angry. My nerves were numb. I watched porn loudly and drank bottles of wine with my friends. I watched from the window as Jeremy diligently drove Charles to his job as a manager of an erectile dysfunction clinic at 6:30 a.m. each morning in a car they rented together, because I wouldn't let them use mine anymore. In text, he swore our love would survive, and I thought about how 1 year ago when I got LASIK, he left me blind at home to play Dungeons and Dragons. I thought about how he used my Best Buy card and forgot to pay it. I thought about every strike that should have been an out, but I also knew I wouldn't trade the last 8 years for anything. Jeremy's love allowed parts of me to come out of their shell because he made me feel safe. Our best memories are dreams I had even before I met him. I missed him so much that week. I stretched out an olive branch, but drew it back when he said he loved Charles like family, which now sounds like an insult to his family. It is. I think he fell in love, which would have been fine, because I get it, that happens. I work with really hot bussers. But to live with it? One of my mistakes was telling Charles he had to move out on the morning of our anniversary, that Saturday, 8 days after the party. I think I did it politely. He responded maturely. I thought we came to an understanding. No need to pay rent anymore, just start looking for a new place with the aim of next month. After the party, I told Jeremy that I was going to ask Charles to find a new place to live, and I expected Jeremy's support. He said it would be there. I came home from work in the afternoon that day, our anniversary, and knocked on the basement door. No answer. I turned the knob. It was locked. It's my house. I have a key to every room, I thought to myself. I decided to open the door. He was so angry at me. His face was red with hate. He told me how embarrassed he was that I had kicked Charles out. It was embarrassing to him, embarrassing to Charles and his family. He had shown Charles and people in his family the text messages we had exchanged over the last week, and they all agreed I was out of control. Like, they could understand because it was a pandemic, but I was crazy. I'm offering him a free month of rent. Like, that's not even kicking him out. You're gonna have to physically remove him. And if you try to kick him out before, we'll sue you. We have looked into this. There were a lot of other words exchanged. He even called his mother to moderate. I waited until he repeated that sentiment for the third time. We'll sue you. That we was the limbo bar I could not get under. I don't know if Jeremy meant everything he said that afternoon. It was the first time he said he didn't know if he could be with me anymore. I find that hard to believe. I am difficult, often. When Jer left me to recover by myself, when Best Buy called, I questioned whether it was intentional or just, you know, irresponsibility. That we made me stop caring about that. COVID doesn't care about that. Seemed like a good lesson. My fiancé on our anniversary was telling me he would sue me over a friend who, before living with us, I barely knew. To say I dream bigger for my life is an understatement. I asked myself if I could still say I do, and I couldn't. I had to burn down the house to protect myself from a future me who would eventually forgive. I'm sorry for what I said to his mother that week when she called. I stayed in my parents' den with my cat out of fear for 4 days after that. But there are moments in life that feel like definite forks in the road. What kind of life did I want? It's 7 months later. I've gone fetal on the couch with ache. I have drank more wine than all of France. The first hot guy I met on Grindr asked me to poop in his mouth. But like Cher, I believe in life after love. And like Tracy, I'm ready to start over. Because I didn't just burn down the house. I lit a stronger flame inside of me. Thank you.
Archie, thank you. That was amazing. See, that happens sometimes. You think the story's going one way, and then it shifts on you, and you're sitting there pretty with your song all chosen, and then at the last second, a curveball. Whoa! Not to worry. I got this. All right. I can't really see it, though. The thing is that I just realized looking at this chart that I don't know how this song goes. Who cares? As Dave Saigon would be telling me at home, who cares? Do it anyway. It's like NASCAR. You come for the crashes. Okay, maybe I do know this.
No matter how hard I try, you keep pushing me aside and I can't break through. There's no talking to you. And it's so sad you're leaving. It takes time to believe it, but after all is said and done, you're gonna be the lonely one. Do you believe in life after love? I can feel uncertainty inside me say, I really don't think it's strong enough though. Do you believe in life after love? I can feel something inside me say, am I supposed to do? Sit around and wait for you? Well, I can't do that. There's no turning back. I need time to move on. I need love to feel strong, 'cause I've had enough time to think it through. Hey, Jeremy, I'm too good for you, yeah. Do you believe in life after love? I can feel something inside to say, I really don't think it's strong enough, no. Do you believe in life after love? Yeah, I can 'Cause I know that I am strong. I don't need you anymore. Jeremy, I don't need you anymore. You motherfucker, I don't need you anymore. Go be with Charles, I don't need you anymore. Do you believe in life after love?
I had no idea that was going to happen. That's the beauty of Voicebox. Plan A, I was going to play Jolene by Dolly Parton. Do it? Okay. Bonus track. All right. Encore. Encore. Jolene, 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 Jolene. Oh, begging of you, please don't take my man. Jolene, 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 Jolene. Oh, please don't take him just because you can. Your beauty is beyond compare with flaming locks of auburn hair. Skin and eyes of them rub green. Your smile is like a breath of spring. Your voice is like a summer rain. And I cannot compete with you, Jolene. He talks about you in his sleep. There's nothing I can do to keep from crying when he calls your name, Jolene. And I can easily understand how you could easily take my man, but you don't know what he means to me, Jolene. Jolene, 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 Jolene. Oh, begging of you, please don't take my man. Jolene, 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 Jolene.
Oh, you could have your choice of men, but I could never love again. And he's the only one for me, Jolene. And I have to have this talk with you. My happiness depends on you. Whatever you decide to do, Jolene. Jolene, 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 Jolene. Oh, I beg you of you, please don't take my man. Jolene, 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 Jolene. Oh, please don't take him just because you can. Jolene, 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 Jolene. Oh, I may love you, please don't take my man. Jolene, 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 Jolene. Oh, please don't take him just because you can. Jolene.
Kathy Richardson, oh my God.
Thanks. Ann Harris. Maureen Muldoon. And all the storytellers, come back up for a bow. Get on the mic if you're Maureen and
thank you guys so much for coming out and supporting us tonight. We had our Louise Ann Harris. We have Mary Louise Edwards. Come on up. Archie Arch J, Terry Falloon, Mr. Voicebox. We have Colleen. Lisa Colleen.
Lisa Colleen.
And Marie Costa. Woo!
Thanks, everybody. And thanks to Colin Peterick at the Jam Lab in Brookfield. You, too, can put on your own show, make your own record, make your own video. Come on down to the Jam Lab. Peace, love, and rock and roll.
Hey, also, our sponsors are on our screen, so you can check out our sponsors. They're the same from last month. We really appreciate them.
Yes,
so
thank you to our sponsors. And if you'd like to sponsor us, you can.
Yes, that's right. You can check out, you can be a sponsor for our show just by checking out our website on Facebook. So I'll even
do a commercial for you.
Kathy will do a commercial
for
you.
Vitamin B to Vegemin. It's so tasty, too.
There you go.
Tastes just like candy.
There you go. So next month we'll be reaching out to people to be sponsors, and we look forward to continuing our shows at Voicebox. See you next month.